Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Rutherford County and beyond. Today, Thursday, June 6, 2024, let's see what lawmakers have to say with today at the NCGA. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter. If you go to ncleg.gov, you can see the latest information. And today, the Oversight and Reform Committee is meeting with the head of the DMV.
We know about the credentials backlog and related matters. Here's what we know. When DMV customers receive services in person or online or at kiosks, they receive a temporary certificate that by state law is valid for 60 days. That is 8.5 weeks. It was a wise decision by the legislature many years ago to do that. Before the present credentials delay occurred, customers are regularly informed that their credential may take up to 10 business days, that is 2 weeks, to arrive in the U.S. mail at their home address. Thus, there is a time cushion of 6 more weeks for the temporary certificate to be valid. In mid-February, as part of her routine duties, an agency colleague discovered that a glitch had occurred over the weekend wherein 2,136 online customers who would not have received online renewals had been allowed by the software to do so. The same day the saddle's malfunction was discovered, DMV and its DITT partners repaired it. In working with the current private credentials manufacturer, we learned that the company would manually retrieve the cards instead of using an automated process. That manual process required the stoppage of production for several days. DMV approved the stoppage for several days based upon the best information we had and what we knew at the time. DMV learned that the company resumed production on March 4th. Soon thereafter, we learned that what had been several days of stoppage had surprisingly turned into approximately a 12-day backlog. As evidenced by the thousands of our internal and external emails, along with the charts we have provided to you, what had been a stoppage of a few days that had turned into a 12-day backlog, then inexplicably continued to grow week by week with the company until, to our customers and our own frustrations, it was taking upwards of 7 and ultimately close to 8 weeks for customers to receive their cards. A summary timeline appears in Addendum 2 of my remarks. We know from the company's reports that at its peak, the backlog had inexplicably grown to 354,697 cards. Fortunately, the company offered in May to provide a second manufacturing facility to cut into that backlog. The records showed that the company's addition to the second facility has dramatically reduced the backlog. Reading their graphs over the last several weeks, by the end of this week, the company has projected it will have approximately 147,559 credentials remaining, a backlog reduction of over 200,000 cards. By the week of June 17th, the company projects it will have cut it to 45,000 cards, another dramatic reduction. Most encouraging is that the company projects it will eliminate the balance of their credentials backlog before June 30th, the end of its contract. You will see that in Addendum 5 of what I submitted previously. What we also know is the following, as I enter the second half of my remarks. DMV began transitioning our driver license offices to our new private manufacturer on May 28th. By the end of this week, 30 DMV offices will have converted to the new company's software, equipment, and credentials, and those DMV employees will have been trained. By the end of next week, we project more than half of all DMV offices will have converted to the new company. And by June 28th, we also project that all 115 DMV driver license offices statewide and online services will have converted to the new company. That new company, by the way, manufactures our credentials just across the state line in Danville, Virginia. If there's ever a problem with our credentials in the future, we can merely take a short drive from here to there. The current manufacturer's facility is in Sacramento, California, and the state has contracted with that company and its predecessors in interest since 1996. Speaking of our new credentials, Mr. Chair, you may have seen the recent news media coverage of or received my update in your email last night. With our new driver license and new ID, North Carolina will have the most secure credential that it has ever had. The new card, our first since 2015, has also been described as among the most secure credentials in the world. Furthermore, our new card looks, feels, and sounds different than any other card we've had, and will greatly enhance our fight against identity theft and card fraud both overseas and domestically. Regarding other related matters of interest to this committee, most respectfully, I share that there appears to be an ongoing disconnect about the significant modernization projects and operational changes that have been implemented by DMV over the last 10 years, and most especially over the last two and a quarter years, hence my reference to setting the record straight. As a courtesy, in a detailed email yesterday, and also within Addendum 1 of the materials for today's meeting, you have received a lengthy list of those modernization changes. You've also received a spreadsheet covering 10 years of modernization changes that have been implemented that folks somehow don't recognize. While there is certainly more work for the agency to do to implement the other modernization projects in our pipeline, and within a state that has dramatically grown by 3 million people since 2000, other than the recent card delay we're discussing today, by every general metric, DMV is doing much better than it was in January 2022. And despite what some persons would have the public believe, I like to remind folks we have filled over 250 vacancies. That means we do things better and faster. We have more online customers. A record number have used them the last 2 years. More online options. We have kiosks at grocery stores that have started. QR codes so people don't have to wait in line physically. They can wait in line virtually if they wait in line at all. The walk-in wait time tool where people can be smart and decide where they go and when they go. Email notifications and reminders, scheduling appointments like at Great Clips. Despite what you've heard, we have that capability and it's working. Also, the biggest change we have coming down the pipeline is our systems overhaul, which is well overdue. That's something the legislature wisely wanted to have done 10 years ago. Well, on my watch, we've actually starting to get it done. And that's what also is coming down the pipe. And we're seeing dramatic changes. These are measurable improvements. And that's just a short list. Finally, some additional good news. DMV starts at Saturday morning hours this weekend. That's also detailed in the emails you've received, the exact locations and the addresses for your constituents. As stated at the outset, I respectfully request that members review my pre-committee written statements and addenda if they have not done so already. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. As stated earlier, joining me are several of the agency's subject matter experts if they are needed. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner. Ms. Shoemaker, you're recognized for your intro.
Ladies and gentlemen of the committee, thank you so much for having me. My name is Lisa Shoemaker. I do serve as the Vice President of our Global Corporate Relations for IDEMIA. I'm here to address issues that have been raised during IDEMIA's performance on its driver's license contract with the North Carolina Department of Transportation and to address the North Carolina DOT's Department of Motor Vehicles used to replace IDEMIA on this current contract. My testimony today will be very direct and honest to the point where some may be uncomfortable as I address the situational facts that brought us to this point. IDEMIA has provided driver's licenses and other credentials to North Carolina residents for more than 25 years. In February 2024, the North Carolina DMV came to IDEMIA after identifying an error made by the department that created a substantial backlog in delivery of driver's licenses to North Carolina residents. IDEMIA responded to this problem, as any longtime partner would, attempting to work collaboratively with DMV to determine the causes of the backlog. Our longstanding partnership with North Carolina matters very much to IDEMIA, and it's because of this partnership and our partnership with 35 other states that IDEMIA can recommend the best solutions to resolve production issues quickly and efficiently. The actions of the North Carolina DMV in this situation and in the past few years have made it clear that the department does not value its partnership with IDEMIA. When the department moved to replace IDEMIA with another supplier last year, they did so without providing IDEMIA an opportunity to even provide a proposal and continued to tell us that an RFP was in process when, in fact, they were already in a contract negotiation with their new vendor. In February, when the backlog issue occurred, the DMV did not act with transparency. They failed to give IDEMIA the full picture. Even the root cause was not fully disclosed. IDEMIA brainstormed and discussed multiple solutions with the DMV. IDEMIA recommended overtime to solve the backlog, which the department refused to even acknowledge. Finally, IDEMIA, recognizing the need for action and being invested in the well-being of the citizens of North Carolina, initiated moving manufacturing to an additional IDEMIA facility to provide the extra support needed as soon as we were able to do so. IDEMIA was able to provide this solution because of the knowledge gained and the infrastructure created through our status as the industry leader in providing identity credentials in the United States. The DMV did not choose to take IDEMIA's proposed solution to address this backlog. It would have been much quicker, less invasive, and it would have assisted the DMV in arriving at a reasonable solution much sooner. Throughout the situation, DMV made it abundantly clear that they did not value IDEMIA's expertise and input. From failing to provide an open competitive bid process for the new driver's license contract, to the unreasonable expectations for contract transition, to blaming IDEMIA for failures of the DMV, the agency has proven it is not a customer that acts with transparency or follows well-established procurement practices, and it definitely does not value our long-time partnership with the state. While we are very frustrated and disappointed about the current situation that we find ourselves in, we are hopeful that this situation can be resolved and our working relationship can be resolved. I'm happy to answer any questions this committee may have, whether it's addressing the credential backlog or the lack of the competitive procurement process. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, may I raise 2 points?
Yes, sir. Just a second. Ms. Shoemaker, you just alluded to that an RFP was you were advised an RFP was in process. Do you have any documentation regarding that type of communication that you could provide to Chair?
I will definitely see what is in print. I know that the majority of those conversations were held in person in meetings with the DMV, where we were continuously asking when we could expect the RFP to be released. You know, as we do this work all across the country, we're very familiar with the typical timelines that are followed. These are massive projects anytime driver's license systems are being procured. And we did make multiple requests and were always assured that there was an RFP coming. It wasn't until I attended a DOT meeting last August, I believe, after us hearing rumors that a new contractor had been selected in North Carolina, that the commissioner shared with the board that they had already selected and gone into contract with the new vendor. But we will definitely look and see what we have in writing that we can provide.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Commissioner, you're recognized for your rebuttal.
Yes, it'll be brief, Mr. Chair and members. Regarding overtime, we as an agency indicated that we would be interested in that, and the ball was in their court, and we never received any proposal about what the cost for overtime would be. If that's been provided, I request with Shoemaker to provide that. We never heard back on what the cost would be. We are thankful that they use the additional facility, which is working great. Second, Ms. Shoemaker mentioned failures and root causes. This is public information because it has been provided to this committee. It has been provided in other places. We've been asked about it by the public. But when we are accused of failures, it is important to note that there have been a great many defects that we have received and the customers have received in cards produced by our current manufacturer. For those who are not familiar with what I'm talking about, and others on the, who are sitting in this room have received these as part of a lengthy 9-month production of records to this committee. We have received cards and the customers have received cards that had persons of color you could not identify on their credentials. You had the state of Illinois put on state of North Carolina credentials and other defects. We've provided that to this committee and other places and in conversations that we've been required to respond to. So whenever there's accusations of deficiencies and defects and failures, I am thankful we are moving to a new company. We've never gotten an explanation as to why there have been so many cards that you cannot tell who the persons are just because they are someone of a different color, and that is just wrong. So we look forward to our new vendor and providing the best, most secure card that it'll be defect free.
Mr. Chair, how would you, I don't want this to be a back and forth in any type. So you tell me how you'd like for me to respond, or we can move on.
Well, I assure you it will not be a back and forth. We will move on. Commissioner, the chair wants to thank you for the plethora of information you forwarded us for our request. I've gone through all those, and I know the committee has gone through a great deal of that information as well. I did want to ask, since you brought up the question or the subject of overtime, was the department's willingness to consider paying overtime an admission of acceptance for causing the problem, or by what logic was the department willing to pay overtime if the fault was actually Ademia's?
Well, as stated in other locations in here, we've had, there have been some delays, nothing like this, but some delays before, and lots of defects. We're trying to solve problems. In every hat that I've worn in public service, Mr. Chair, and I've worn many hats in public service, is about solving problems. And the problem is that there are multiple causes, and yes, there was a software glitch, but that doesn't explain why 2,136 cards grew to 354,000 card delay. I don't understand it. But what we do know is that we wanted to solve a problem. So whenever we were presented with an overtime option, we first thought, well, it's going to be the same number of cards that they're having to do what they're supposed to produce. Why would there be overtime? But we also want to solve problems. So we responded after we got through that discussion and didn't hear back, what would the cost for overtime be? How many people would it be? What would it entail? Thankfully, as I've shared with Ms. Shoemaker and also stated in other documents, including here, we appreciate the solution that was offered of basically doing double production so that we could answer this particular concern. So it's about solving problems. That's what it was about. And whether it's overtime or whether the second facility, as indicated by their own charts, and if I'm misreading them, I'd like to hear that. Their charts show that they're going to have eliminated the backlog before the end of June.
Mr. Chair, if I may, my team has confirmed.
Recognize Ms. Shoemaker.
My team has confirmed that we will be able to provide documentation of us submitting over various scenarios of overtime and the costs that would have been associated with each of those options to the DMV. So we'll have that to you by the end of the day.
All right. Thank you very much. The chair has several questions, but I'm going to defer to my committee first to see if any member would like to ask some questions. Please raise your hand to be recognized. Ms. Cunningham, Representative Cunningham, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So question one, and this will go to, I want to say representative, but both of you will have a question. It went out, didn't it? Okay, excuse me. The RFP amount that was awarded to the original ADINA, the state amount awarded for the contract, what are we paying them? That's what I'm asking. What does that contract designate the amount to come out of our budget to pay them?
Talking about for the current vendor?
Yes, for the current vendor, the Ademia.
I do not have that information. That contract goes back many, many years. We've provided it to this committee and to others who've asked for it.
Okay, well, I did ask for it when we couldn't find it. Okay,
I do have the price per card, if you're asking about that.
No, that's not going to help me. Thank you. Okay, the other question is, when the RFP was awarded and the contract was decided and awarded to them, inside of the contract, if they don't perform at what their expectation is within the contract, if they did make an error and have to go to the process of asking for overtime, would that not have been inside of the contract that they have not met what you all asked for them to do? What's in place for that? Because if they're not fulfilling the contract, they got behind $300,000, but they requested overtime, that would have been an additional expense to the state. What is in that contract that says if you don't fulfill your obligation to the state, we're not going to award you overtime? We expect you to fulfill your obligation within that contract without doing overtime. Is that in that contract?
And Mr. Chair, I need to confer with one of my experts behind me because these contracts go back a long time. You'll bear with me
That's
one moment.
Fine. Committee members, at this time, the chair has Representative Chesser in queue. If you want to be recognized and I missed you, please raise your hand now. Thank you, Representative Cervantes.
Mr. Chair, I believe I have an answer for the member.
Please.
Okay. As stated earlier, the division has contracted with IDEMIA and its predecessors in interest since 1996. The basic contract that we're following right now predates me. But it's my understanding we're not aware of any overtime provisions that were built into the original contract. I'm not personally aware there. I stand to be corrected, but these contracts go back in session, you know, it's consecutively back to 1996. So we have learned, going forward with our new contractor, as anyone would, of what needs to be in contracts, but we're not aware of that in the current contract. But I'm happy to be corrected if that's not the case.
Do you have another? Are you okay? Representative Chesser, you're recognized.
Just a suspenseful pause there. Thank you. If I didn't write it down, I'd forget it. So I appreciate your patience there. I don't even know where to start. I have so many questions left over from last time you were in front of us, Commissioner. And so I apologize, Ms. Shoemaker. I may not even get to you today.
No worries.
So there's a pattern here, and I'm one who notices patterns. And so we'll get to that in a second. But first, I want to talk about kind of where we left off. April 12th, we got a letter from the DMV Senior Deputy General Counsel, Drew Marshall, who's present, explaining in there, and when I confronted you guys about selecting a vendor that could not print in color at the time. You recalling this, Commissioner?
Actually, it can and do print in color
now, but at the time it was stated that they don't print in color. And in the letter it says DMV had good faith, a good faith belief at the time prior to and shortly after entering into the contract that the state might be amenable to amending the statute if in fact it were necessary. Because what was explained to the committee was the belief of the department was that grayscale counted as color. That's what was expressed. So on what evidence did DMV place this good faith belief?
Because the General Assembly had changed it before. It's been back and forth between requiring a color photograph and not requiring a color photograph, as I understand it. So the General Assembly has done it before. And given that, Mr. Chair and Representative Chesser, given that part of the statutory requirement is to provide the most secure card using best practices, that was also part of the determination with it. And based upon the previous legislative activity on this point.
So you had conversations with legislators about changing the law prior to entering the contract?
Spoke with the previous secretary, as I understand he had had.
Not a legislator.
Who said he had spoken with legislators. And beyond that, again, past practice is that it had been changed.
Okay. So what I may save my next section of questions for a follow-up. So I want to roll right into, so I'm seeing a pattern of essentially disregarding current law. When it comes to color photos, you guys made a decision and then assumed we would change the law to match your decision. And then in a proposal, you guys wanted to go to renewals every 16 years, which violates the Real ID Act. I guess you assumed that someone would change that law as well. Now in awarding this contract, you guys used the latitude offered to you to be able to provide five contracts through your own process, correct? You guys have the latitude to make five contract decisions outside of the normal processes, right? Statutory?
That was legislation that passed before I was commissioner and is not something I requested, but that right.
That's how this contract came to be, was through that authority. Correct?
Yes, correct.
Okay. That allows you to enter into five contracts. Is it also your belief that allows you to just forego the due process and bids and proposals and bid requirements that are required to enter into state contracts?
We followed what the law was interpreted to us as it being.
Okay.
And then that's, you know, be happy to discuss further, but that's what the law is. And
so one of the basic fundamentals of state procurement is making sure you honor a fiduciary responsibility to the taxpayers. What process was actually followed to ensure that that happened?
As stated previously and in the other records that have been provided, we tracked the process, even though it wasn't required under the DMV-5, we tracked the processes for procurement that DOT uses. And I'd like to point out that with the current card with the new company is one penny less per card than what IDEMIA was charging in June of 2020 to North Carolina. So with the new, more secure card that looks better, feels better, is better, that is updated, it's one penny less per card than what IDEMIA was charging the state in June of 2020.
So you guys followed standard state contract procurement processes?
It's my understanding we tracked the processes as our procurement and legal professionals.
I don't know how else to word a yes or no question.
Representative Tisser, well, your time's expired. We'll come back to that.
It's also a matter of litigation, Mr. Chair. I'm trying to answer the questions. We'd answer these before as best we can, but this is one of the things, there's litigation on that point, and I'm happy to direct you to the litigation, Mr. Representative.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioner. Representative Cervini, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chair. I want to preface this by saying that we're here for the people of North Carolina. There's a lot of questions before and probably after me that's going to have slants, and I'm going to try to ask questions of both of you to be as business as possible. I want responses that are business, not feelings, because business and money is not about feelings. Okay, I'm just going to ask this. So I am concerned that we have had a longstanding contract. As springboarding for my colleague, it sounds like there's not an evaluation process to see that with changing populations, changing requirements, has this contract been updated, and is there evaluation and collaboration in terms of settling what problems can be arising proactively? Either both. I'd like to ask that question to both.
It's my understanding that we had two brief extensions of that were allowed by the contract from the original contract. We've had with this vendor contracts and its predecessors and interest going back to 1996. I'm not sure about the rest.
I'm very concerned that there's an original contract from 1996, but we're in 2020.
Right. And that's
and why North Carolina looks so different from that. I think we have staff who weren't born yet since then.
Right.
I always refer that to that. So, and I know the question was already asked, what is the process if there is a trouble, an issue? And I'm not going to ask it again, but I would like to receive that.
I would simply answer this way. There are weekly meetings between IDEMIA and DMV, as I understand it, between our points of contact. And then there are other meetings and calls as needed when issues arise. Because of and this has been provided to this body and in previous times, particularly as you look at the defects log, there have been ongoing and regular conversations, even without those errors, there have been regular ongoing conversations as a matter of course between the agency professionals and IDEMIA's professionals. So there's been ongoing dialogue on trying to help resolve problems. We didn't always get a root cause, but we did, as far as I could tell, tried to work collaboratively over that extended period of time.
So you're saying conversations, mostly in technical environments, there's a triage, very well documentation, even a software that's like in complement to track this by stages of solution.
Yes.
Is this in existence that could track what issues have occur and what solutions are implemented?
Yes, we provided that in a previous iteration of a legislative committee.
Perfect. Okay, so I'm going to go directly to the issue of the 2,000 to the 336. As a data person, I would actually like probably go into Access, cross match, and pull out the 2,000 and then run the rest of it as it goes along. That's my rudimentary understanding of what I would have done as a solution. Why was it the option manual? Please explain that to me.
Absolutely. Thank you. So I do want to address your earlier question, though, in terms of the changing landscape in North Carolina. I believe that that is an excellent justification for why a competitive procurement should have been utilized in this particular instance. IDEMIA has been the longstanding partner of North Carolina. We were certainly hopeful to continue that, but we always welcome and believe, you know, the commissioner mentioned that his new card is 1 cent less. How would he even know what the IDEMIA price would have been proposed if we had gone through a competitive procurement? So being able to state that they negotiated in the dark a lower price when no other vendors were able to come to the table and provide a price is exactly why a competitive procurement should have been used in this instance. To your second question, though, and I am not a data person representative, so I've spent a lot of hours in preparation for this hearing today to try and answer that question. So when we were notified on February 20th of the errored file that had been sent over from the DMV's software system that had the glitch, we immediately recommended a process where you fail the folios, and the folio is that data file that comes in from the state every day. That would have been the most expedited and an efficient way to have stopped production on the credentials that had come through either I think the 19th was our original date that we were concentrated on, but as DMV continued to investigate into their problem, the credential issue actually went back to February the 16th. So we had to stop processes or attempt to, you know, stop processes that were already in production because our normal SLA for providing these credentials in North Carolina is 5 business days. The DMV refused to allow us to use the failed folio option. And they are the ones that required that it was a manual process. And unfortunately, because of when we were notified of the issue and the fact that that production was already in progress, there was actually no way to pull those until those credentials went through the entire manufacturing process. Because once they are stamped out of the individual sheets, you have to get it all the way to the mailing phase in order to manually go through and pull out those 2,000 plus credentials. So not only did we have 5 days worth of files that had to be stopped, that was 5 days of the backlog, then we actually had to halt production for an additional 5 days to sort through all of this. And the employees that had to manually select those out of the thousands, because we print over 10,000 credentials a day for North Carolina. And my CEO and I actually traveled out to Sacramento last week to the factory where your credentials are produced to have face-to-face conversations with the team that were responsible for this. And from every record that I've seen, all of the meeting notes that have come out of it, our team attempted on multiple occasions to provide North Carolina with the most efficient resolve for this. And we were forced to do a manual process.
Okay, I know that
Commissioner was... Excuse me, Representative, your time has expired. We will come back to you. Representative Cleveland, you're recognized for 5 minutes. And Commissioner, I see you want to respond. We'll get back to you.
Yes, sir. It was with my expert. Yeah, I wanted to. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Shoemaker, can you tell me what the date is on the present contract that you have with the state to produce the ID cards?
The date that it expires?
No. What date is on the present contract? When was the present contract actually brought into force at what date?
I do not know the month, but 1996.
I cannot sit here and believe that any corporation in today's world would work off a contract that's 20 or more years old. That's crazy.
I'm sure there have been revisions because, as the commissioner mentioned, our company has changed ownerships throughout that time. So I will certainly consult our lawyers representative and come back to you.
Commissioner, Can you tell me what the date is for the present state contract with Endemia?
Whereas the original was 1996, I've been informed that there have been approximately 15 changes or revisions.
When was the last one?
I would need to consult with the team. There have been 2 1-year extensions that in the 2 recent years, but I'm not sure of any substantive edits to it. But I'll be happy to get the specific information.
With no substance, this boggles my mind.
I agree.
It really does. Can you tell me, Representative Cunningham asked, and I don't understand the answer you gave her, do you have a performance clause in your service contracts that require the person performing the service to pay for their faults?
With the new company, we have learned lessons from our current company.
I didn't ask about the new company. In all your service contracts, this isn't the only one you have.
I would need to consult with our business office director who's here. He would be the expert on
that. A yes or no answer would suffice if you could give me that.
Mr. Chair, I'm not Mr. Shelton. I'm not sure if he's the best person, but he works with us on contracts. May I confer with you?
Yes, absolutely.
Mr. Chair, to answer Representative Cleveland's question, I've been informed that there was a huge change in 2012, which is referenced in Exhibit C of the current contract. There were lots of changes made then. Be happy to provide what that is. But so that's the most recent significant change with this company, which was 12 years ago.
My question was in general. You don't have to answer it today. You can send it to the committee.
Yes, sir.
Do you have performance contracts or performance articles and service contracts with anybody you deal with?
I'll be happy to locate that.
You stated that the new company's cost for the card is 1 cent less than Endemia's present cost. I seem to remember reading someplace that for them to give us a color photograph, they'd have to spend $31 million to upgrade their processes. Number one, did they upgrade their processes, which they must have to get us a color photo? And who spent the $31 million? The state or the company that you're contracting with?
Certainly will supplement my answer to this, but the addition of color added approximately 31 cents to the car per car. Previously, it would have been approximately two, with the new company, would have been approximately $255 per card, whereas in June of 21, it was $254 with the current contractor. By adding color back to the card, it added approximately 36 cents. The price per card for a most secure card ever is now $2.91 per card, which, again, as I've stated earlier, IDEMIA charged $2.92 per card in 2020. So it's within the range of what IDEMIA was charging under the existing contract.
Okay. So you don't know who... Did the state pay additional money for the present contractor to produce a color photo?
It was to upgrade the equipment and software. It was less than $4 million. To have a new card, even with the current contractor, there would have been certainly charges to design their new card too, with new equipment.
Who paid the cost, the state or the contractor?
Since the state's requiring color, the state does, but there's a pass-through in terms of the cards being what the customers pay when they get their credential.
Representative Cleveland, your time has expired. We can go back to you on this second go around. Mr. Shoemaker, the chair would like to know, I have information that says the cost of your card is currently $2.55. Do you know what the cost of your card is to the state?
I do not, but I will try to have that when we reconvene at 11.
And Commissioner, just for clarification, earlier you stated the cost of the card was a penny less than what we're currently being charged by IDEMIA, but it comes back to, now with the addition of color, there's a 31-cent charge additional. Is that what we're hearing?
Mr. Chair, several points. One is that the IDEMIA's price per card between June 19th and the present fluctuates. That's in the contract. It went from 228 to 210 to 292 to 254 to 228, 254 to 228.
What causes a fluctuation?
apparently it's in the contract. That's what was negotiated based upon what IDEMIA determined, and I would have to defer to the folks who were involved with that contract. To be clear, the new contract with the new vendor for the price per card is $2.91. It was 36 cents extra. Subtract 36 cents from the 291, that gets you to 255.
Yes, sir. I understand.
Yes, sir.
And I think to Representative Cleveland and to Representative Chesser's point was that because of the oversight or the willingness of the department to make assumptions on what would the legislature might do in regards to this statute that requires a color photo, you've gone ahead with a contract, and we can discuss whether or not it fell within the purview of the five exemptions the department was allowed. We can discuss that a little later, but essentially what it resulted in was an additional cost to the state over and above what the original contract with CBN was. So now you've also just testified that, and I don't clearly understand, perhaps Ms. Shoemaker can tell us what causes a fluctuation. I don't understand how we sign a contract, and I know there's a logic behind it. I just don't understand it.
I have some information, Mr.
contract
Chair.
With fluctuating cost and know what we're getting into, but I don't know how you can determine that the cards that we're going to get with the new vendor is less than IDEMIA's unless we know what at least they average out to.
Sure. Yes, sir. May I? The current cost per card here in North Carolina today is $2.28, and the price fluctuates based on volume. So there are different volume metrics in the contract. So obviously, the more credentials that we produce, the less expensive they are.
I was going to say,
yes, sir.
From my experience in processing
it. So it would be very difficult for us to say definitively that the new vendor's card is going to be 1 cent less than IDEMIA, considering that the price is not fixed.
Okay. Mr. Chair?
Yes, sir.
That assessment, respectfully, is based upon designs that were done prior to or during 2015. If you're talking about, well, we don't know what they would charge. We do know they've been trying to float other numbers to us in recent weeks and months. But the price per card to include color with the vendor that we have going forward is less than the price that this company charged at its peak.
Thank you, Commissioner. I think that's a moot point, to be honest with you, because we have a contract with a new vendor.
And it was amended.
But I think what I'm getting to is what Representative Cervantes has asked for. Just the simple truth, the simple answer suffice. Representative Stevens, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. And I'm not sure I would take a full 5 minutes, but I think some of my questions have to do with grayscale and color. Clearly, IDEMIA is already set up with color. We had to pay more money for this person to set up with color. This person's color was still a higher price than at your lowest production. So I have concerns about that. I will tell you my personal experience. I had some pretty significant changes to appearance. So around April 15th of this year, I went to DMV to get my driver's license updated, just a picture change. They gave me a little temporary license in grayscale that didn't look a thing like me, I didn't think. And I was not allowed to vote with that card. They specifically said you cannot vote with a temporary license. Luckily, I had an old license that they would accept, but the new license was not acceptable, I guess because it's not as legible or readable. My DMV person told me, it will be 6 to 8 weeks before you get your license. And it was almost 8 weeks before I got that license. So I'm surprised that if you've already been working on getting that backlog done, Were you taking first in, first out, or were you taking the more simple things first, just first in, first out?
Representative, in my conversations with our factory staff, when the folios come in from any state, they are printed in chronological order. And that is a best practices for any type of data file of the size that, you know, we would be expecting. And so that certainly played into the backlog that was created, because we did have those 5 days of production that had to be halted and then manually inspected before we could start back with the new folio, you know, the clean version of that once the 2,000 plus credentials were removed.
Okay. And on those credentials, it's my understanding that the 3 days of files that were initially caught as screwed up were February 16th, February 19th, and February 20th, so a Friday, Monday, and Tuesday, not a full 5 days. Is that correct?
Mr. Chair. It's my understanding it's February 16th through 19th. The subject to Ms. Shoemaker, I believe that the days they give the reports is the next day.
Correct.
So it's February 16th through 19th, which was over a weekend, which is why on that Monday, when our colleague did a regular routine as she does after coming out of a weekend, she discovered that there was an error. She was discovered that somebody had gotten gotten a renewal online who shouldn't have. She then requested a ticket with DITT to look into this and realized that there was some malfunction. That malfunction was solved that day. We still have difficulties, respectfully and honestly, trying to figure out why 2,136 cards led to the 354,000. We also don't understand why, with a company as expansive as this one is, has a manual process instead of automated. And Mr. Chair, I know I have the director of driver services who had a sentence or something, a statement about this folio reference that Ms. Shoemaker mentioned. I don't know when that would be the appropriate time to ask him to come forward, but it was February 16th through 19th. And it's in the written statement that's online for this committee.
And so the glitch was caught right away and was fixed right away, but then we're told factory production didn't start again until March 4th?
Correct, because when we were notified on February 20th that these files back to 2016 contained errors, we halted the production on the 20th. Then had to go through and continue printing those to get them all the way through to then manually pull the credentials as per our instruction from the DMV. And then at that point, we had received folios from the 20th, the 21st, the 22nd, the 23rd. So we ultimately ended up with 10 days worth of credentials that had to be printed and it took several days, unfortunately, for us to get to the bottom of exactly how many credentials DMV was looking for.
So apparently DMV caught the glitch. So the glitch
was their software system.
We discovered the glitch. We repaired the glitch. There had been other problems and delays before. We approved several days of shutdown to help. We didn't want to have 2,136 unlawful cards going out to people who then would be caught in a situation where they have an unlawful card. So we're protecting the public by doing what we did.
I understand, but what was the glitch? Where did the glitch come from? Did it askew some numbers? Did it askew some addresses?
No, ma'am. It allowed folks who should have been prevented from renewing because they couldn't have a photo more than 16 years old. You know, when you're online, you can alternate between in-person and online. A lot of times folks go online and they forgot that they were online the last time. So there are 2,136 people during that February 16th through 19th period who should have not gotten that transaction processed. And we discovered that and we fixed it the same day.
So now the process is that a person comes in, they've got to have their new picture. There's a place in the system that's caught that.
Oh yeah. I mean, this was a one-time thing. This is not. It was a glitch, and it was repaired the same day. So there's no problem with that.
Representative Stephens, I'm sorry, your time has expired, and we are going to at this point recess for 45 minutes. Session I've been told should last about 30 minutes. I've been told a lot of things since I've been up here. So I'm going to give us 45 minutes. We will recess now and reconvene in this room at 11:14.
Very interesting. There you have it. Today, the NCGA, the Oversight Committee, is meeting.
That's 11:45. Excuse me. Okay, this will be at 10:45, not 11:45. There was a glitch. That's
very interesting. So just a reminder, the North Carolina General Assembly does not typically archive their meetings in a meaningful way with full video. So I'm attempting to do that here. I will link to all of the documents that they have shared on their website, but you can view that too at ncleg.gov. Thanks for watching. Part 2 coming up.